that sell oils in these products. For us though, we can say, well guys, if you put an aquaculture facility next door and you combine that water and reticulate that water, you've now eliminated your fertiliser issues. You've gotten rid of the OH&S issues with handling chemicals, we've gotten rid of that all the safety aspects that go with it. And we're just limited to a few OH&S issues here. From the aquaculture perspective, we said, guys, if you put a hydroponic facility on the side, you can take this waste stream, you can eliminate the amount of water you require, so your water costs are reduced as the price of water goes up. Some of these farms use mains water, some use bore water, but to increase their quota, they have to buy more water. We know that's going to be an expense, and the buybacks and all the things that's going on. So then look at, okay, we've got to take that water out. So we can say to these guys, if you put one of these on the side, you can reticulate your water and at the same time have a byproduct, which is value-added, and you can get an EPA tick of approval. So we can increase the productivities of the two industries. So how do we have a look at those different facilities? The NFT system is seen here is used by the hydroponic industry. It's usually a basin of some sort or a sump. Chemicals are added. The water runs up to the top here, runs through very small channels back into the tank. There's little tiny cups in here, which we can see. And in those cups, they put plants, and the plants then grow in those little tiny cups. I'll just pass this around. And we'll have a look at this in a second. But that's from that perspective. Then the aquaculture perspective, we normally have a number of different types of equipment. In this case, what we used here was we have filtered water. And thank you, guys. What you deliver to us is pretty good. There's not a lot of chlorine and chemical bombs in there for us, so it's pretty good, but we still filter it. But that water goes into the insulated shipping containers through primary mechanical filters, through biofilters and degassers. It's pumped to other pressurised vessels, goes through UV sterilisation, ozone. So the whole process is quite complex from an aquaculture perspective. On the other side, the hydroponic side, the water goes from primary mechanical filtration through to the hydroponic sump, to pumps, to secondary. So it becomes quite complex, and the waste from there go to water reclaiming technologies. This is typically how you have to combine two industries together. What we're able to do is eliminate a lot of this and just make it one pump, one tank system, and one growing system. So we can totally eliminate the amount of components required. So let's just have a quick look here at some of the things that would be required. We have, in this case, we have culture tanks, we have filtration, we have delivery lines, we have media, in this case the NFT that we talked about, and this is what we use. And then we'd have return lines back to the system. So this is a typical, simple, keep it simple system. From our perspective, we had to look at components that we could use that could be bought perhaps quite fairly efficiently and cheaply if you were in a country town or maybe a second world country where there was some components. And we also looked at, well, on the other case, if it was more complex and people could purchase with an expense their mechanisation and some of the other things. So we had to look at two different types of mentality of people purchasing this equipment. So in our case, we looked at, typically in aquaculture, we use drum filters where the water is passed through a filtration screen. As the waste is moved up, it's continuously backwashed into a chamber and the water is totally constantly running out. Much like that flow that we talked about that's coming out of the previous slide. What we decided to do was we built colander filters, colander being the effect of bending water. So as the water runs over a weir, over here, the water bends to the shape of the wedge wire, the water falls through and the wastes are collected over here. We can take that waste stream out, or that solids waste, and reduce the amount of water that's being used for backwashing. Then we have biofiltration. Normally we use bioballs for degassing, etc. We decided to use anaerobic type of filtration. And by using the anaerobic type filtration, without having solids pass through there, so that reduces the amount of water we need for backwashing as well if the system became dirty. Then we have our UV sterilisation. Now we don't use that very often because we don't want to kill those bacteria we spoke about last week. And by using UV, we kill the beneficial bacteria as well as the non-beneficials. But we do want to get rid of pathogens if they do increase in the water quality. And we'll get that tested. There's more pathogens, then we can increase that productivity. That's from a fish perspective. Then we can increase productivity by turning on the UV steriliser and DNA and RNAing those pathogens that are in there. Then we also have ozone saturation or oxygen saturation. We inject 95% pure oxygen into the system. As the water travels down this vessel and the pipe size, the diameter increases, the pressure releases or the pressure relieves as the air tries to go up with the normal rise of air bubbles. The water's pushing it down, so it slowly dissolves into the water and we get that high concentrations or saturations of water. So these are some of the things that we looked at. looked at heating. Well, we used a split system just to keep hot and cold. And the reason it worked well for us as a split system because we took these types of devices or these types of refrigerator containers or reefers, double skinned. We can put in our tanks and we can keep the temperature fairly cool or fairly warm and hold it at temperature because we've got the atmospheric temperature inside that we've contained within those double skin walls. So very efficient, very cost efficient, and also very easy to transport from one place to another. We can bring the truck in, hook up a container and ship it to another site. So from a research perspective, this worked well for us. Here's our nursery and nutrient production room. We've got five tanks in here, I'm sitting on one. And inside there we've got fish, in this case they're rainbow trout. And you can see there's about 650 fish per tank. And as they're growing, we're just graded there. As they're growing out, we'll take those fish out, grade them, put them in the next tank and so on until they end up in the end tank, which is like this one here, and we'll take those fish out and they'll go to market for about $14 a kilo.
Andrew, are you treating other different species of fish?
Absolutely. We've got a license for 54. We're currently doing barramundi, we've done some jade perch, we're also doing some silver perch, golden perch, Murray cod. We've done quite a large variety of species, catfish, etc.
How does the quality of fish growing that method compare with...
That's part of our activity. You're actually going to do a little activity on that one.
Cool.
Good, because I knew you liked food. So. From our plant nursery grow out. Now, if you know any of these plants, call them out. Tell me what they are. I've got them in the box here anyway for you to have a look at. And I won't pass them around, but I'll certainly I'll just put them over here.
20 minutes.
Thank you. So you can see them there. All right. So from our aspect, we've got plant nursery grow out. We've got vegetables. We've got oats here. We've got collards, etc. We've got basil. We've got a variety of different types of lettuces, bok choy, strawberries, Vietnamese kangkong. Vietnamese basil, kangkong. Flowers. We've pretty well tried all of these different types of things. Sweet basil grows in about 6 weeks.
Mexican tomatoes.
Yeah, 6 weeks we cut them. From here to here, 6 weeks. We're selling it for $2 a bunch. They're making $40 a bunch out of it. So we're only in research, not there for commercial gain, but for the aspect of these people to be able to use them and test it for us in the market worked well. Fancy lettuces, different types of lettuces here as we can see. OFP, omega fish products, we get a bit bored sometimes, we write stuff in. Basil, there's a whole variety of different things that you can see. Kenkong, this is 3 days, this is from the morning, that's 3 days old. Mm-hmm. Okay, so give you an idea how quickly that grows. That's 2 weeks, that's 5 weeks. All right, so it grows just crazy. Spring onions, no, you can't grow spring onions, well, proof's in the eating, I think. So there's the proof. Flowers. Quite a large variety of different types of flowers that we get. To gain the efficiencies, we need to look at the amount of nutrients that are available. So if we look at, from a fish perspective and a plant perspective, 6.5 to 7 is the range that fish and plants require. If we have a look at our nutrient elements here, we'll find that 6.5 to 7 is pretty well where the thickest part of those elements are. So it means that running at those different species together, we can actually get the benefits of nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, sulfur, etc., all the way through. We're able to use the most of the nutrients that we can out of our system without losing any or antagonising any nutrients. We look at our nutrient concentration as far as our solution of aquaculture water, pH, nitrogen, potassium, phosphorus, all these different things, and we came up with these numbers. Now, what does that mean? Well, we compared them against a generic hydroponic nutrient solution, and what we found was that we were far lower than a lot of these requirements of genetic hydroponic solution. As we travelled around the world, we discovered that, hang on, they're all getting the same results. They're using less nutrient, but they're getting more production or more plant production and getting the same results as if the hydroponic guys were growing. So that meant to us that the efficiencies of nutrient availability of the plant roots was there. So we're quite amazed that it wasn't just us that discovered it, it was on a global perspective that everyone had the same results. So the efficiencies of nutrient recovery by the roots, just by running the two systems together, are far more efficient than running chemicals or in the traditional grounds. Alright, nutrient clarity assimilation. We've got here floating beds. Now these are chinampas that the Aztecs used 1,000 years ago. They make reed beds, put in some seedlings, the roots would grow through, and they strip the nutrients out and they grow plants. They didn't know the science of it, how it worked, but they did know that it did work. So they used those methods, and 1,000 years later, we're just modernising that technique. And if we look at here in China, they're using roots such as cannas, etc., rhizomes, and they're flooding them on beds, the same as we saw here before, flooding them to strip out or bioremediate nutrients out of large reservoirs that have been polluted over time. So something in India might work very well in using those types of productions. The water clarity is amazing when you see the water clarity in comparison to what it would be if it was just aquaculture water. I did have a slide there, but for time I took it out. Typically, deep water raft culture is used, and that's where they run a fairly large bed, 12 inches of water, and they run these floating beds up here just to make the nutrients run past the root zone. I'll use it this way, but we decided to use NFT because we've got the hydroponic industry already in South Australia, we've got aquaculture already. There's no point showing this type of technology and saying, guys, this is what you've got to do. It's more, guys, this is what you've already got to play with, let's integrate them and get more efficiencies out of it. And the proof's in the eating, of course. We've got the plants that we talked about before. It's my colleague Gavin holding some plant there. And then we've also got the roots that are nice and clean. You can see that the filtration of the whole system works so well that the roots don't get pythium, they don't get moulds and all those other types of things we'd expect in plant production. Get Jane to help me. Inside there's a little bit of fish. You're going to get a piece of fish each, and also some lettuce that you're going to trial out as well. Some gloves there for the trial. So this is smoked. No, I only smoked them last night.
You get dinner and a show.
You're going to try that. And then you're going to do for me a hedonic scale. You're going to do a hedonic scale for me. And hedonic scale is a pleasure scale. And it's used by food technologists to work out. The qualification of foods that are produced, and they compare it against other types of feeds. However, only one type of food can do it. Know what it is? There's some instructions there. As you try the fish or the lettuce, I'd like you to put an unhappy face for "I don't like it" to a very smiley face for 10 out of 10. So we're going to try those different parameters here of texture, flavour, appearance. I've got their texture twice, sorry, I've changed it, I've inserted it before. So just ignore that texture again. The texture, flavour, appearance, and any other comments you'd like to put in there. Yeah, in conclusion, we find that integration becomes more efficient as we combine the different industries, that we require only tanks, pumps and some media beds as compared to other types of equipment that might be necessary, that there's no chemicals required as far as occupational health and safety issues, but certainly there's no chemicals required in production because we've already got those organic nutrient fertilisers that are produced. Our water efficiencies are the best today on a global scale, and also our production quality is in the eating. So have a good taste of that. And fill out your sheet, and I'll pick those up for you later on. Don't put your name on it, we'll pick it up later on. And finally, I know you're eating all, but